Hello. Welcome to my continuing series on Bergson and his holographic theory of mind. This is part six, and we'll be talking about thought or the dynamic transformations of thought, images and imagery versus cognitive science, which can't handle images and imagery. The concrete versus the abstract, that is the origin of the abstract in the concrete. The whole notion of broad computation as opposed to standard Turing computation, rather the broad computation that Turing also allowed, in which the device that Bergson described the brain as being, namely a reconstructive wave passing through a holographic field, demands. So when we're talking about the imaginative transformations of thought, a good place to start is the Gestalt psychologist Max Wertheimer in his book Productive Thinking in 1945. Wertheimer was observing children in a classroom, and they were being taught via drawings of a parallelogram on the blackboard the traditional method of computing the area, naming by dropping perpendiculars to find the area. This method turns the figure in effect to a rectangle for easy computation of the area, length by height. He was astounded when he himself went to the board and drew a slightly rotated version of the parallelogram figure, because he was shocked to see that the children failed to extend the method. That is, they couldn't extend and drop the perpendicular method at all. And they knew not what to do. They exclaimed, "We haven't had that yet." Yet, outside the classroom, a little five-year-old who looked at the cardboard cutout of a parallelogram asked for scissors so she could cut the triangular end off and move it to the other side to make a rectangle, so she could now compute the area easily. So here we have quite a move, a dynamic transformation of that cardboard triangle, where she simply cuts one end off and rotates it over to the other. But better yet, there's a dynamic transformation exhibited by another five-year-old child who took the cardboard parallelogram and simply folded it into a cylinder. Then she asked for a scissors to cut it in half, announcing that it would now make a rectangle and she could compute the area. So needless to say, Wertheimer was quite shocked. One reason being that the children in the classroom were virtually rooted, glued into this algorithmic method and had unlearned how to do any dynamic transformations of thought themselves. On the other hand, how dynamic the thinking was, the imagination, the transformations exhibited by these two little gals that he studied outside the classroom. It's this dynamic folding transformation, among others, where we fold the cylinder or the cardboard parallelogram into a cylinder that Penrose used, Roger Penrose, in his examples of what he felt and what he termed non-computational thought. These were forms of thought that he felt could be handled by the computer model of mind, could not be handled by the computer model of mind, and his foundational concept of computation. What he did in his example of non-computational thought was consider hexagonal numbers, such as the one I'm showing in the picture there, a little hexagon arrangement of 19 little circles or beads all arranged in a hexagon. That's a hexagonal number. You can read 7 is also such a 1, 1, etc. And his proof was that successive sums of hexagonal numbers are always a cubical number. It is a number that can be arranged as a cube, and hence this is a computation that does not stop. So it's a proof of a computation that is infinite. This is to say, I can add one hexagonal number to the next and always get a cubical number for an infinity of such additions. So what he does is he has us imagine initially folding a hexagonal structure, namely that little 19 element hexagon that I showed you, into a three-sided cube. Each cube has a side, a wall, and a ceiling, so three sides. He then has us imagine building up any cube by successively stacking, another transformation, these three-sided arrangements, each giving each time an ever larger cube. So for example, we start with the number one, cube being one times one times one. We take our folded seven element hexagonal number, fold it over and stack it over that little one. That gives us eight, or two times two times two, the cubical number. Then we take our 19 hexagonal number, fold it, stack it over the eight, gives us a total of 27, or a three times three times three, the cube. Then we take the 37 element hexagonal number, stack it over the 27, gives us a total of 64, or four times four times four, and on this goes. This is a dynamic transformation over time. In fact, multiple transformations with invariance across each. We can expand the hexagonal structure successfully from 1 to 7 to 19 and beyond, each time preserving the visual hexagonal invariant. Then each is folded successively, each time preserving the three-faced structural invariant. Then imagine them successively stacking one upon the other, each operation preserving the cubical invariance. Over this event, the features or transformational invariance of this operation or transformation are defined. Now Penrose asks, what if we had two operations and two numbers, 3 by 5 or 5 times 3? How would we know that the result is the same for each? If we multiply 3 times 5 or we multiply 5 times 3. He pointed out that a computational procedure to ascertain the equality of 3 times 5 or 5 times 3 would involve literally counting the elements in each group one by one to see that we have 15 in each. So we count the elements in each group. But he noted, we can see this equality that must be true by also visualizing the array. Namely, here we have a 3 by 5 array. And if we rotate this through a right angle in our mind's eye, and we'll do that right now, we can see that nothing has changed. 5 by 3 must equal 3 by 5. That is, we have invariance. The number 15 is conserved over the rotation. Now, therefore, it's to this perception of invariance which Penrose gravitated as a natural exemplar of non-computational thought. And this is the form of thought which he required, which requires consciousness. Now, this indeed requires consciousness, we have seen, because these transformations must take place in a non-differentiable flow. And these perceived invariants form his obvious understandings that became building blocks for mathematical proofs. For example, the cubical invariant, the hexagonal invariant, the three-sided cube invariant. Each time I make a transformation that forms one of these little hexagons into a three-sided cube, I have an invariance. And invariance, these obvious understandings, Penrose felt, are inexhaustible. And we've seen an example of this. If we hark back to the catapult and the spoon, for example, where the spoon exhibits a structural invariant necessary for launching peas, when placed or inserted in the invariant structure defining catapulting. We'll be talking more about this emergence as we go, and ultimately on part seven a bit too. So we've seen Roger Penrose's example of what he thought was non-computational thought, and the fact that he had gravitated to transformations and invariants. Now, the formal definition of computation was provided by Alan Turing, and it was embodied in an abstract computing machine I've discussed earlier a little bit, consisting of a read head and an infinite tape with instructions on the tape, and termed the Turing machine. And I think I've noted that all current computers, including neural nets, are simply concrete versions of the Turing machine. That is, they are always doing computations that fit the definition of a Turing machine. Yet Turing specifically defined the form of computation that he would formalize in terms of mechanical operations. He was thinking of the ubiquitous types of computation then found everywhere. The calculations of a bank officer balancing the ledger, or of a clerk computing a total cost of purchase. So computation, as Turing defined it and thought of it, consisted of the steps a human computer could carry out. That is, a human acting mechanically without intelligence. That is, without semantics. And when I say without semantics, I mean without any meaning in reality, because the computations could be carried out mindlessly, robotically, as though a machine. It was this form of computation that Turing would formalize in terms of the Turing machine. Now, this captured the mechanical knowledge and calculations of the parallelogram challenge children in Wertheimer's classroom. In other words, the ones that were trained to follow the precise algorithm and could do nothing more, even under the slightest necessity of a transformation when the parallelogram was rotated. But this computational definition did not capture the form of computation of the five-year-old who asked for the scissors to cut the edge off. It did not capture the dynamic transformation exhibited by a five-year-old who formed the cardboard into the cylinder and then asked for the scissors to cut it in half, as we've seen. These are dynamic transformations of thought, and the computation is going on in a different form. Now, obviously, if thought is truly non-computational, it is then beyond the computer mode. It is beyond the capacity of computers and computation, for it is beyond the computation of a Turing machine. Therefore, the computer as mind theorist attacked Penrose mercilessly. Penrose had not only done his book, Shadows of the Mind, but published an article in Behavioral and Brain Sciences, which I had like 30-some responders to that article. And his idea of non-computational thought was ridiculed, critiqued, etc. None of his critics noticed that in his examples of non-computational thought, Penrose had gravitated towards transformations and invariants. That is, none of his critics grasped the significance of his examples, or perhaps wanted to. Turing, however, discussed computation beyond his Turing machine definition. He described something called oracle machines, or O machines for short. One example of it that's given of a what would be a tiny O machine is a protein, where the protein effortlessly solves finding its optimal three-dimensional configuration. And it does so by responding to and using physical forces in what we can call the analog domain. So we're talking a domain that's far richer than even the word analog describes. This is considered a near intractable computational problem, but the protein solves it effortlessly, concretely, using concrete forces. In the foldings and stackings of the hexagons to form this proof of a computation that does not stop, that is, we're doing a transformation of cube upon cube, folding hexagon upon cube, and recognizing, perceiving that there's an invariance here which can extend to infinity. The brain is doing something neurally, to be sure, to allow us to perform this visualization, to construct an image. But where is the actual computation occurring? That is, where is the perception of invariance occurring? Well, the point is, it's not just in the brain, it's in the four-dimensional being performing the time-extended continuous transformations supporting invariance. That is, performing the dynamic transformations of this imagery such that the invariance emerges. So this brings us, since what we saw is complete reliance on imagery, to the question of images. These are tough little creatures as far as cognitive science is concerned. For Bergson, in Matter and Memory, he insisted that there are no images stored in the brain. As an example, in the context of storing the auditory images of words, he remarked, "Now consider for a moment the amazing consequences of an hypothesis of this kind, namely storing images in the brain. The auditory image of a word is not an object with well-defined outlines, for the same word pronounced by different voices or by the same voice on different notes gives a different sound. You must assume that there are as many auditory images of the same word as there are pitches of sound and qualities of voice. Do you mean all of these images are treasured up in the brain? Or is it the brain that chooses? Or is it that the brain chooses? If the brain chooses one of them, where does the preference come from?" So here we have Bergson discussing the same problem we noted earlier in part four on storage and the notion of, for example, storing the transformation of a biting face, as Barcelos did, where we simply take three states of the dynamic transformation that is biting, and we ask, where does the preference come from? What is the principled method of selection by which you would choose these elements, states of the biting face, or features of a rotating cube? Or in this case, in the auditory image context of words, which word are you going to store from all of the different pronunciations, tones, qualities, etc., that are involved in that particular word? In other words, this problem hasn't changed. It hasn't gone away one bit. And as I noted before, I still think it's Bergson's book, Matter and Memory, that is still the only real discussion available that attempts to look at whether or not we can store memory experience in the brain as opposed to what is indeed stored in the brain, tries to parse these two out. So I will note that in chapter two there is a long discussion on this particular question of storage of images in the brain, this history of it to his point in 1896, and I'm simply going to say nothing has actually changed. For Bergson, the image is a virtual object, or a virtual event, better, in time. Remind us of our four-dimensional picture up there, where we are four-dimensionally extended beings, and that four-dimensional extent of experience, however, is not extended, spatially extended dimension, rather an inextended dimension. And for Bergson, the brain assumes the appropriate motor attitude to allow the event in the past to actualize as an image. For example, to recall the image of our house being struck by lightning when we were 3 years old. Now, in the integration context, this was cast as modulating the reconstructive wave appropriately, and the modulation pattern being driven by the invariance structure of events. So in essence, we're driving the reconstructive wave through that four-dimensionally extended experience. I make a caution here. It's not entirely accurate to be saying modulating a reconstructive wave in this context. That is, the four-dimensional extent of the transforming matter field is inextended. The four-dimensional extent of the transforming specification, that is our perception of this field, is inextended. That is, we don't exactly have holographic reconstruction here. At minimum, the wave pattern that's being created via the event structure is resonant with the past event structure. And how the virtual object or event meshes with the brain as matter, when we become conscious of it, I think this requires a further revamping of our understanding of matter itself. And trying to go into that a bit, but I'm going to hold that for the voluntary action discussion, because it's also involved in voluntary action, where images actually drive action, drive the brain. So just saying, the driving a reconstructive way through the four-dimensional extent of being, of experience, to reconstruct events has a great degree of accuracy, but it's not entirely the story. But at least we have the basis for imagery. In current cognitive science, what we have is total confusion on the status of images, on the very existence of images. We're going to look at that now. Images are pesky things in cognitive science. One very influential theorist who wrote on the subject was Zenon Pilishin. Early in the game, he initially denied any need for mental images. And now by early in the game, I mean early near the birth of cognitive science and the simultaneous conception, therefore, that the brain is a computer and doing computation and using data structures. He argued that if images are simply constructed via the data elements and rules for manipulation, as you would find in a computer program, then the image is simply redundant because all the knowledge is in the rules and data structures in the first place. That is, all the knowledge is embodied in the programs that access the data structures and put those data structures together, so-called, in supposed images. Remember, these images in the computer be entirely attributed via an external observer in the first place. As he said, in other words, the image has lost all its picture-like qualities and has become a data structure, meeting all the requirements of the form of representation set forth in earlier sections. In fact, it can be put directly in one-to-one correspondence with a finite set of propositions. In other words, simply verbal strings. Similarly, seeing the image has been replaced by a set of common elementary and completely mechanical operations, such as testing the identity of two symbols. So though we asserted that the experience of the image is literally not to be questioned, one has to ask, well, why not? Because we've worked to the point where, with a great sigh of relief, we can throw those pesky things away. They are indeed difficult to account for or justify in a computer. Even if the machine were to generate an image, who would then look at it? It's a useless effort, surely, given that we can't obtain any knowledge from it since we generated it in the first place from the data structures. So indeed, we'd be right back to our homunculus looking at the data structure and the image constructed thereby, and back into our infinite regress. So this is indeed a curious gloss in our earlier discussion of the problem of perception. For it makes it quite clear in the case of the perceptual image, that cognitive science and the machine model of mind truly don't need an image of the external world at all, which indeed they don't. Gosselin and Koenig, two cognitive scientists and imagery theorists, defended imagery's existence, but were a little less logically consistent than Piaget. To quote, "We use imagery to access stored information about an object by generating an image, then inspecting the imaged object for the sought information. This is accomplished by first looking up a description of the object in associative memory, and then using the code corresponding to the object to activate the appropriate visual memory of the object. This will produce a spatial pattern of activation in the visual buffer, which is the image proper." There's multiple problems with Gosselin and Koenig's view, but I'm going to focus on one of the obvious ones. The statement, "the spatial pattern of activation in the visual buffer is the image proper," question. For the visual buffer here is simply a screen on which a picture or pattern can be displayed. This is typical theoretical sleight of hand, for the picture pattern is, again, only a pattern of neural activity. This is what the visual buffer is. It's a neural chunk of neurons. How can it be a pattern of neural activity and the phenomenal experience of the image as well? That is, the coffee cup and stirring spoon. If it's a neural activity pattern, what is the experience of the image? And who sees it? The problem is the visual buffer is only a handy theater for viewing by the theoretician's friend, the homuncular eye, and we know that's an infinite regress. We don't know who it is that's looking at the visual buffer, or how we explain then the person behind the person looking at the visual buffer onto infinity, nor do we know how they turn a neural pattern into an image in the first place. Now, Gosselin and King argued that this regress, I just noticed, is easily avoided. They argued that the mind's eye is simply a set of tests after the computer analogy. A matrix of values defining line patterns can undergo certain tests, for example. So I have a matrix of values perhaps coordinate values, defining where lines are, and I can see if two lines meet by at a point or diverge by a series of computer tests. And these tests constitute seeing the image. So the visualizing computer programs working on matrix values and somehow transforming that magically into seeing an image. They haven't explained at all how you move from these neural activity patterns to the coffee cup and stirring spoon. In truth, this is simply the coding problem that we talked about in part one long ago, revisited. Remember, I noted that three dots can stand for an S in Morse code, the three blind mice, Da Vinci's nose. The problem is, how is a domain known to which the code is mapped without knowing the domain in the first place? In this case, the domain is the external world, the coffee cup, and how does one know that world by means of the code in the first place? So 30 years later, Piaget was back again in behavioral brain sciences asking again for a discussion on the problem. Again, while not denying their existence, he again challenged the cognitive science field to explain why images are needed. He particularly focused on Koslin and Koenig with arguments similar to those I expressed and in more depth. His challenge was in the form of a null hypothesis. That is, his hypothesis was there is no need for images. Now, prove the opposite. Though he was admitting that his abstract symbol manipulations are likely insufficient to account for the form of our representations take when experienced as imagery, namely as the coffee cup and spoon, for example, that we can image, he asked any future theory to explain why not. He noted, for example, that formal language and symbolic calculi at least meet the dual requirements of compositionality, which is abstracted elements or concepts, and systematicity, that is lawful manipulation of the elements, essential for reasoning. Now, for example, the concept cow, the concept brown, are compositional extracted elements from our experience of cows, of brownness. And I can put them together systematically. The cow is brown, the brown cow mood, by the rules of language. Again, we could have stirs, spoon being elements, and the spoon stirs being systematic composition via the rules of language. I put stirs and spoon there because to make it clear, we're talking about, again, dynamic events with invariant structures in reality and concepts formed over these events, as we'll soon see. Piaget went on. He contemplated certain mental folding experiments where subjects were required to mentally fold paper into objects of certain forms. He noted that the subjects had, by necessity, to proceed sequentially through a series of folds to obtain the result. So again, just like Penrose, Piaget is noting that in order to fold something up properly, like that shirt, I've got to mentally go through a series of folds to end at the configuration that's the targeted configuration, like that folded shirt there. Why is this? Because he argued we know what happens when we make a fold. So we have to go through a series of folds. We know how to make a fold, and we know how to put then compose a series of folds to end up at a certain state of the shirt. And this has to do, he said, with how one's knowledge of the effects of folding is organized. So again, in the concept of imagery, he's admitting that, well, there can be these mental image transformations. And indeed, it seems to be based in our knowledge of events of the external world, like folding, stirring, bending, stacking, etc. But he's asking why you actually need this, because meanwhile, he's thinking that everything is actually, according to the computer model, taken care of by this sheer symbol manipulation, access to data structures, and computer programming, all without imagery that's going on beneath. Now, Aaron Sloman, in a seminal paper for an AI conference in 1971, already had given Piaget his answer as to why we need imagery, why we can't escape it, and why, in other words, we are more than simple computers manipulating symbols. Sloman contrasted the syntactic mode of representation with its symbols and rules with what he termed the analogic mode. The analogic mode is, in essence, the mode of imagery, or what can be called the figural mode. In the analogic mode, he noted, there is natural representation of constraints for this Reed and variance laws. So just as the cup and coffee stirring, the paper does not bulge and shrink, the cup does not bulge and shrink while it's being folded or stirred. The cup doesn't disintegrate. The paper doesn't disintegrate. The edges stay stable on the paper and move to overlap one another. One surface generally stays stationary. So these are constraints and variances of the process of folding or the process of stirring. And they're there, those constraints are just naturally there as part of the structure of the event. Remember the long discussion we had about the invariant structure of the coffee stirring event. With all of the invariants, the flow fields, the adiabatic invariants, the ratio of frequency, energy of frequency to energy of oscillation, the inertial tensors, the flow and form of the cup, tau ratios, etc., all in, as part of that stirring structure. It's all there in the analogic mode. So these constraints, or these invariance laws, are defined naturally within these events, in the concrete events, such as we saw in our discussion of stirring previously. On the other hand, in purely syntactic rule system, what's termed failures of reference are commonplace. For example, here is a set of syntactic rules on the right, straight from Noam Chomsky and his syntactic structures for language, for language grammar. The syntactic rules, for example, are a sentence is defined or rewritten as a noun phrase plus a verb phrase, NP plus VP, in the corner of my picture there. A noun phrase is a determiner plus a noun. So determiner down in the bottom of the rule set is can be the or a. And we see a noun, an N is in my little system here, leaf, building, shadows, sidewalk. A verb is a verb plus a noun phrase, and a verb is smoked, attacked, hit in my little system. And with this little system, we can generate sentences. For example, the first rule generated sentence I'm showing there is the leaf smoked shadows. I can have other legal sentences in this little system. The leaf attacked the building. The sidewalk attacked the shadows. The building smoked the leaf. Shadows hit the sidewalk. So these are all perfectly syntactically correct according to that rule system, but the semantic sense becomes highly questionable. We don't normally see leaves attacking buildings or buildings smoking leaves. Now, this was of course, recognized it was called semantically deviant sentences. And to stay within the same rule system attempt, various assaults on this were made, and still are, of course. For example, we invent what are termed semantic rules or semantic markers. In this case, we might mark leaf as an inanimate object, and inanimate objects will have a rule saying they cannot attack or hit. Now, you can see some problems with that already, but very quickly the problem is we can conceive of events instantly in the human mind. Well, we can see that in a cartoon a mad leaf attacking a building and even knocking it down. That would make some sense. In the meantime, we see hit can't be inanimate, but nevertheless, certainly a rock can hit something. So that rule starts to fall apart right there, and we end up fairly quickly with rules for relaxing the rules. For example, maybe we'll let leaf attack a building, and this ends with such a sloppy, rickety, unpredictable system that the whole system collapses. And this is the ultimate failure of syntactic systems. It's what's called the brittleness of syntactic systems. So there in my picture on the right is my little invariant structure, so to speak, for coffee stirring with liquids resistance and, of course, things like adiabatic invariance within their full fields, etc. And so we can have the syntactically correct, the paper screeched and burbled as it was folded, or the stirred coffee surface exploded in small geysers, or as he stirred, the coffee went snap, crackle, pop. These are nicely syntactically correct, but they make a little strange, if any, semantic sense. That is, they instantly violate the invariant structure of folding or stirring events. So for Sloman, all the way back in 1971, already, this was the greatest challenge faced by AI, namely achieving this analogic form of representation, or what I've called achieving actual representation of the invariant structure of events. Or another way of putting it is achieving common sense knowledge, because that's precisely what we're talking about here. And it's the great unsolved problem of AI, common sense knowledge. And I'm not noting it on the slide, but it's also part of the frame problem of AI. So if we recast Sloman's challenge, it becomes, what type of device is required to support this form of representational power? This is only to ask what type of device can support perception. There's no visual imagery, for example, without visual perception. So the image, when we're talking about transformations of images, is a function of perception and, of course, the memory of this perception. And in turn, the image is knowledge, or carries that knowledge within it. The flow fields, the kinesthetic aspects of it, the adiabatic invariance, the inertial tensors, etc., all carried in this multimodal image. So it is no less knowledge than the actual perceiving of an event of folding is simultaneously knowledge. So where we are going to is that all abstraction is necessarily defined over something concrete. There is no abstract transformation of bending. For example, something is being bent, whether spoons, our body, the body of our smileys up there, or the law. The abstract bending as a symbol is in reality an invariance, having no reality other than its definition over these concrete events. Again, what is a fold other than an invariant defined over these transformations in concrete experience? Be it shirts, beds, folding cardboards to make cylinders. And so we've seen folds made in sheets, made in paper, made in arms, elbows, sails, folds made by Penrose in three-face hexagonal structures to make cubes, even folds a little more abstractly with poker hands. Something is always being folded. There's no such thing as an abstract folding. Fold is not simply an abstract symbol among other abstract symbols. Now, a linguistic sound, such as bend or fold, just as a piece of grass can become a symbol for Jacqueline's grasshopper, can be employed as a symbol for this invariance of folding, but the invariant itself, the folding, is non-existent other than as an invariance across all these folding events. So what we should think about this invariance in terms of is as a reconstructive wave sent through 4D being. I'm not going into the Bergsonian justification for this, but it's there in Matter and Memory. So it's as though we're driving a reconstructive wave through the four-dimensional extent of experience. And in the holographic analogy, then, it's a composite wave, not entirely precise, but enough to preserve the invariant structures of these events, and forming a composite across, reconstructing all this, these events as a composite. And over this set of events then, set of coffee stirrings, the variants wash out. The variants being the type of hand, the type of cup, the type of spoon, the type of surface. The variants wash out, the invariants, the actual structure of stirring, remains. Galton long ago noticed this in terms of a stack of photographs of faces. You stack the photographs of faces, and over the stack an abstract face emerges. Again, the invariants wash out, the invariant remains. Gelernter, a computer scientist, in the book The Muse and the Machine, talked about a stack of events. And at high focus, as he termed it, that is a rather abstract focus across the events, we have a concept, in this case, the concept of stirring. So what this says is that concepts are actually very dynamic. Casasanto and Lupien, in a 2015 article, began espousing this notion that all concepts are ad hoc, that is, all are dynamically formed via retrieval cues in the moment. No concepts are actually truly stored in the brain. They all are being created in the moment via context-dependent retrieval of experience. And no concept is ever quite the same from one time to the next. So as it were, we're sending a reconstructive wave through our four-dimensional memory and creating on the fly a concept defined across our stirring events. This sounds radical, but it's where Hofstadter and Sander, in their Surfaces and Essence books on analogy, actually arrived. There's a key event in this book it's seminal, foundational throughout the book in their thought about analogies and concepts. In this event, the main author, Douglas Hofstadter, or DH, is visiting the north rim of the Grand Canyon with his wife and young son, Danny. In the midst of this scene of great majesty and splendor, Danny bends down, intent on watching some insects in the sand. So he's interested in the insects more than the Grand Canyon itself. Many years later, Hofstadter is visiting the great temple of Karnak. And his friend Dick suddenly seems more focused on bending down and peering at a small bottle cap, an object for which he has an obsession for collecting bottle caps, on the ground. The former scene at the Grand Canyon comes rushing back to Hofstadter in memory. So what we have is a reintegration, a classic reintegration of an event, the original event E at the Grand Canyon, E prime, Karnak event, E prime, reintegrating E, and we have an analogical reminding, that is reintegration. Because in truth, I didn't stress this, I don't believe in my, or maybe some degree I did in my reintegration discussion on part four. In truth, all reintegration is analogical. I think I mentioned this in terms of us sitting there watching the wind chimes and reminded instantly of buying wind chimes for my wife, or the spoon reintegrating a catapulting event, etc. So this, notice the concept here is attention on the trivial in the context of a grand geological or architectural scene of great majesty and splendor. Note how this concept or feature emerged over the analogy, actually over the analogical reminding operation of reintegration. Feature here is equivalent to a concept. Notice how dynamic this is. This is, was again, a dynamic emergence of a concept. And what we have here is the analogy defining the features and not vice versa. But for this to happen, this requires the availability of the totality of experience. Only this can account for the continuous, creative, yes, ubiquitous emergence of ever new concepts. And this is what Hofstadter and Sander thought was critical and remarkable about the phenomenon of analogies. The analogies are just continuously emerging, and these analogies actually are ultimately, in fact, concepts. The problem here is that without the totality of this experience, we can't account for the fact that there are many possible encodings, as Hofstadter and Sander would have said, or encoded concepts for these events. For example, other possibilities for encoding other than just trivial event or attention on the trivial in the context of the grandiose. For example, a guide at Karnak extolling its grandiosity could have served as well to drive the retrieval of the Grand Canyon experience. Perhaps also with a Grand Canyon extolling guide to include Danny's presence. Or a sudden breeze stirring the desert sands at Karnak could retrieve the Grand Canyon experience, which also could have had a sudden breeze. A hawk soaring over Karnak could serve for retrieval of the Grand Canyon experience with hawk. The conversational mention of buying hot dogs by the souvenir stand or walking up a steep slope to the Karnak temple. Again, possible retrievals for the Grand Canyon experience. Danny's flapping shirt tail could have retrieved the same experience. The question is there then a limit to the possible encodings? So Hofstadter and Sander were caught in a dilemma because there were so many possible concepts that it seems to require that you'd have to store all of experience to account for the possibility of any of these things emerging, but they could not conceive of how all experience could be stored. In other words, we're back to the dilemma that Bergson addressed. So they considered and rejected the idea that all events are would be stored something akin to unindexed videos on DVDs. In other words, they're trying to imagine how you would store the entirety of your experience, in my case for 70 plus years, in the brain, as though it was being stored, engraved in real time on CD after CD after CD. And so way back there, I've got the Grand Canyon. And then 10 years forward, I've got Karnak. So if Karnak is the present, I have to, in order to define that Grand Canyon event and the similarities, given they're unindexed, it is, I don't have an indexing of bending down in the presence of a great magisterial event or scene. I simply have to search through all these videos and find something that seems to match. Well, they couldn't imagine how this is possible. So they said the moral is that we do not store in our memory a collection of objective events through which we run, seeking perceptual resemblances, whenever new events happen to us. In other words, Karnak being the new event that happened to us. Rather, the events that befall us get encoded, that is, perceived, distilled, and stored in terms of prior concepts that we have acquired. So in other words, they're voted for the abstractionist position, that is, reduced or distilled. Notice the word distilled elements, reduced elements stored in the brain, like our faces, Barcelos biting, carrot biting faces. But again, you're instantly in the problem of no principled method of selecting of these elements. Right back, same old problem. Again, I would note these authors, Hofstadter and Sander, had no understanding of Gibson, therefore the invariant structure of events, therefore of reintegration, or what therefore becomes the natural indexing or content addressing, as it's sometimes called, the natural retrieval of the Grand Canyon event via the structure of the Karnak event. So in reality, they simply removed the Grand Canyon event, also the Karnak event, and simply stored something like a concept, like attention on the trivial. But then they're left in a bootstrap problem because now they can't explain how you get new concepts all the time. So I note that Hofstadter and Sander had actually held the following notion, namely that concepts are in actuality dynamically formed analogies in the first place. Each concept being, quote, a long succession of analogies made unconsciously, continually enriched over our lifetime. So this is exactly what we saw Casasanto and Lupien say. So they're reinforcing each other. That is, all concepts are dynamic. We're driving a reconstructive wave, so to speak, through our four-dimensional memory and forming these concepts on the fly via reintegration. Now, obviously, they're not totally and completely brand new and created every time. There's something that is brain-based that's driving this reference wave, But nevertheless, because that four-dimensional memory is continually expanding, and the state of the brain and the modulation state can be a little different each time, the concept can be a little different each time. Now, without Bergson's four-dimensional model, they, being Hofstadter and Sander, or Casasanta and Lupien for that matter, have no way to achieve this, because you have to have the totality of experience available. So I always get asked, especially by reviewers looking at papers, well, what about truly abstract concepts like justice? Because it seems to be a malady of the academic world that we can't think through something a little more extensively than perhaps presented. But high abstract concepts like justice are nevertheless still invariants over perceived events. In this case, it'd be over perceived events of justice. For example, a little brother gets whacked for launching a pee at sister by dad. Or a little brother swipes big sister's french fries, but meanwhile, little sister is swiping brother's soda. So yes, this notion of invariance of events can handle various levels of abstraction. Now, it's a common misconception of the computer metaphor, however, that the abstract can exist without the concrete. All we need are abstract symbols and their manipulation. In Piaget, however, the abstract is indeed defined upon the concrete. And I want to go through Piaget's notion of concrete operations and the inherent reliance on images, dynamic transformations of imagery that cognitive science has no clue how to handle. It was the failure to realize this total reliance on the concrete that supported the illusion for many years that Piaget was amenable to the information processing model. I mean, cognitive science is quite convinced that they've handled Piaget, but in truth, an entirely different form of device is required for Piaget, namely Bergson's model. So AI understands artificial. What it doesn't understand is the implications of the developmental trajectory or developmental path required by the child to achieve the ability to perform cognitive operations. We saw that Piaget described the developmental path existing across fairly many elementary tasks. We looked at just a couple, for example, seriating a set of sticks in height, in order of height, or coordination of two different velocity water flows. But one task I wish to discuss that is really the essence of his definition of concrete operations, which take till about the age of 7 to form. So even we're talking now an even longer point of developmental trajectory, is the tunnel bead experiment. This is found in the child's conception of movement and speed in 1946. And it's a simple experiment with children aged 3 to 7. And what we have is three beads strung on a wire, which in turn can be fitted into a small cylindrical tunnel. The beads are of different colors. We'll call them A, B, and C. And the beads are run into the tunnel, and the tunnel is semi-rotated 180 degrees from 1 to N times. So run into the tunnel, rotate the tunnel, and out they come. And notice in this case, in that 180 degree turn situation, they've come out in a different order. C leading, then B, then A, whereas they went in as A, B, and C. So the order switched. So a series of questions is asked the children. ranging from what order will the beads come out after one semi-rotation we just saw, in other words, they come out in opposite order, or what order will the beads come out after a full rotation, a 360-degree turn, and that's in which case they'll come out in the same order, to the ultimate question, the order of the beads after any n number of half turns. For example, what's the order after three turns? What would their order be? After five turns or four turns, etc. Well, the children go through a series of development through age 3 to 7, a set of stages. The interesting point comes when the child comes to a point of development where he can visualize the consequences of a 180-degree rotation, which moves ABC to CBA. Okay. And then another 180-degree rotation, which moves things back to ABC. So in other words, we have an invariance of order under a 360-degree rotation. Under 360-degree rotation, the original order is unchanged, ABC. But we're now asked, in which order would the beads come out when the tunnel is rotated 5 or 4 or 6 or 7 times? He evidences great difficulty. In other words, he hasn't quite understood the invariant yet. Some children appear to be exhausted after imagining 3 or 4, possibly 4 semi-rotations. They become lost when jumps are made from one number to another, i.e. what's the order when there's 3? What's the order when there's 5? So what they're doing, you can see, is they're imagining. They're performing the dynamic transformation of the rotation of this tunnel and the beads coming in and out, just as Penrose performed the dynamic transformation of folding his hexagons into cubes and gradually stacking them. So Piaget says, but since the child upon each half turn endeavors to follow the inversion in every detail in his thoughts, so he's following for each rotation, he's visualizing each half rotation. He's visualizing how will his beads come out. He gradually manages accurately to forecast the result of 3 or 4 or 5 turns, half turns, half 180 degree turns. Once this game of visualizing the objects and alteration is set in train, he finally discovers that upon each half turn, the order changes once more. Only the fact that up to this upper limit, the subject continues to rely on visualizing intuitively and therefore needs to image one by one the half turn is proved, because he was lost when a jump is made from one number of half turns to any other. So the child is intently visualizing the rotations. When he's asked, what's the order after 3 turns? He visualizes the rotation, then another one, then another one, each time. So after this gradual perception of a higher order invariant, that is the oscillation of order defined over the events of a semi-rotation. So in other words, if I semi-rotate, if I have 180 degree rotation, I'm going to change the order. Another one, I'm going to change the order again. Another semi-rotation, I'm going to change the order again. There comes a point where the child can easily answer the ultimate question for the resultant order for any n turns. In other words, ask 3, he'll say the order changed, is inverted from ABC to CBA. Ask 4, he'll say the order is the same as it went in. So here is his description of what he terms operational thought. Operations, one might say, are nothing other than articulated intuitions rendered adaptable and completely reversible, since they are emptied of their visual content and survive as pure intention. In other words, the operations come into being in their pure state when there is sufficient schematization. Thus, instead of demanding actual representation, each inversion will be conceived as a potential representation, like the outline for an experiment to be performed, but which is not useful to follow to the letter, even in the form of performing it mentally. So all he's saying is that these very concrete imaginations of half turns are ultimately reduced, become so schematic that you can barely realize that they're happening. And this is his operational thought. Utterly dependent and completely dependent, my point is, on the imaginative transformations upon which they're built, and ultimately just become, as it were, so automatic that we don't need the clear visualization of these transformations. So according to Piaget, operations, freed of their imaginable content, become infinitely compositional. So by compositional here, he's conceiving of the fact that we're putting together these compositions, these rotations, for example, semi-rotations are compositional elements, and we can put them together systematically or compose them half rotation by half rotation to form these results. So we are looking at the origin of the compositional in this sense that Piaget thought was so important, and that he felt the standard computer model with its symbol manipulation gives us. Here we're looking at the origin of the compositional in the sense of the rotations becoming compositional elements and being put together systematically. We also looked at the origin of the compositional in terms of concepts, in terms of stirring being a invariance across concrete events of stirring, bending being a invariant across concrete events of bending. In other words, these symbols also are compositional elements that can be systematically put together. The brown cow, the stirring cup. This freeing of from the imaginable content, the schematization, as it were, becomes the basis for forecasting the result of n turns. And this is a development that takes the child to the age of 7. So the operations become the generalization of actions performed through mental experiment. But this is not simply abstract rules or symbols. These operations don't exist save on top of the imaginative transformations on which they're built. So as I just said, they do not exist without the dynamic figural transformations or images. They're the result of a dynamical developmental trajectory required by the brain as a self-organizing dynamic system, and it requires 7 years to complete this path. And again, as already noted, looking at the origin of compositional composing capability and elements thereof in this as well. And this is in no way covered by cognitive science. And the notion that they're capturing Piaget is a complete illusion. Again, it's worth noting that it was precisely, again, this form of developmental trajectory in the previous case we studied over the first 2 years that results in cost, causality, object space and time, the ability to symbolize, and the ability to support explicit memory. So we're carrying this on from ages 3 to 7 into concrete operational thought. Piaget carried this further into what he called formal operations, which we're not going to go into. It is precisely these developmental trajectories based on the manipulation of concrete experience, invariants defined across concrete experience and transformations, that robotics theorists seem to believe can be simply ignored and somehow manufactured in one fell swoop via programming of their robots. So cognitive science has persuaded itself that it can handle Piaget and his supposedly abstract operations. We've seen they're not abstract. They're simply schematic transformations born of concrete images of events, rotations, bendings, stirrings, the exact thing neither AI nor computer models know how to account for. Beneath Piaget's operations, there resides Bergson's device. That is, a four-dimensional being with a brain as a reconstructive wave that can dynamically form these images and events from his experience. Again, whether we deal with invariance over transformations or change over transformations, we've entered the realm of time. These are time extended, cubes are rotating, tunnels are half turning, flies are buzzing by, hexagons are folding. And we've seen that this time extension cannot be conceived simply as abstract, as an abstract series of instants. To support intelligence, to support cognition, we require a device that supports time-extended transformations and invariance in continuous form. In other words, we require consciousness. We need a memory that expands, that spans the instants. We need a conscious device. So we viewed here the form and nature of the understanding underlying what we can term a semantic computation, that is a computation based in the concrete invariant structures of events. And it is clear that the Turing concept of computation is purely derivative. By this I mean that computation in the Turing sense is simply a residue, a spatialized husk of a far more powerful operations of mind supporting representative thought, which are in turn based on the non-differentiable motion of the matter field. The manipulation of discrete symbols in an abstract space and an abstract time cannot support this, nor will a dynamical device that cannot support perception. As I've noted again, we're looking for a device that's oriented to a far more concrete purpose, as concrete as a generation of field of force, that is a very concrete waveform in a concrete non-differentiable time, a wave that supports a broader form of computation, is broader than Turing's narrow definition, but consonant with a broader definition he did in fact leave fully open. So in a word, Turing computation is a limiting case. It's fundamentally based in the projection frame of the ever underlying abstract space and abstract time in which we tend to think and theorize. And it's itself a derivative concept from perception and its objects, or the objects and motions defined initially by perception and then rarefied into abstract space and time. And this is the frame we have to peel away in cognitive science as well. So next time, we'll be talking about consciousness, evolution, and AI and a bit more on analogy. We'll see how consciousness and evolution and AI tend to reinforce each other. And again, how they both fail along these lines. An analogy will play its role. I'm trying to finish that off. On the road, free will and voluntary action, mind and variance in education. We have to talk about Bergson and relativity and Einstein. And I've added one here, Bergson and quantum mechanics. As I've run across a book, an exposition of quantum mechanics and the transactional interpretation that I think gives us enough purchase finally to make sense of quantum mechanics, that we can see how it could mesh with Bergson. So next time, evolution, consciousness, and AI. Until then, signing off.